Good morning. I'm Rob Sparks, one of the pastors here at First Presbyterian Church, and I would like to welcome you to worship in person, but also those persons who are watching online or on WSB radio or watching later in the week on AIB. One of the ways we have of knowing who is worshiping with us at any of those times is by encouraging everyone to use the QR code, which will either appear on your screen or it's on page 13 of your bulletin. So there are two different ones, one for first-time visitors, and it will ask you for some information so that we can connect you with the church and get information from us about what's going on in the life of the church. The other one is just is the regular visitor check-in, and it will just ask you, if it just says, welcome, you don't need to do any more, you will get a link to the bulletin so you can follow what's going on in the life of the church. I do have an announcement I'd like to lift up. One is that the church will have its all-church retreat on Labor Day weekend. That's September 2nd to 5th, staying at the Montreat Conference Center in the beautiful mountains of North Carolina. I was in the mountains of North Carolina yesterday, and according to my car, when we started leaving the mountains, heading back to hot Atlanta, it was 67 degrees. So I encourage you to go there, rest, renew, worship. The deadline to register is August 1st, so that's coming up soon. And we would like to congratulate Catherine and Ben Bondurant on the birth of their son, William Leroy Bondurant, who will go by Roy. He was born on June 21st. The proud grandparents are Stuart and Lisa Bondurant. Don't have any other announcements, so if you will join me now in our call to worship that's printed in the bulletin. From near and far we gather. The house of God is our home. Here we are no longer strangers. In the body of Christ, we are one. Let us worship God.
Thank you. Friends, we live in a beautiful world, but it is not a simple one. And if we say that we have no sin, then we deceive ourselves and the truth is hidden from us. So let's stand together as we stand before God and confess our sins using the prayer of confession in our bulletin. Holy Triune God, we confess that we have not lived for your glory. You claim us as beloved children, but we do not honor your name. You call us to paths of righteousness, but we fail to follow your way. Forgive us, God of grace. Break down the walls that divide us from you and from one another, and build us up into the holy temple through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will be abundantly pardoned. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen.
Be seated. I'd like to invite the children who would like to go to godly play to meet over here. Is Katie coming in? Yeah, there she is. Got a few takers. All right. While the children are leaving, I'll turn over to our scripture.
As we continue our series in Galatians, we will be reading Galatians 3, chapter 3, 26, and then it goes on to chapter 4. Listen now for the word of God for you and for me. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you are baptized into Christ, have clothed yourself in Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. My point is this: heirs, as long as they are minors, are no better than slaves, though they are the owners of all property, but they remain under guardians and trustees until the date set by the Father. So with us, while we were minors, we were enslaved to the elemental spirits of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Let us now turn to God in prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, here we are, continuing our summer sermon series in Galatians. And I'm afraid I'm going to have to suggest that you do what I suggested the last time I was in this pulpit. And that's, if you have not already seen it, go back and watch last week's sermon, because it was a great tee-up for today's lesson. Of course, last time it was Kate's sermon that was so wonderful. Last week it was Reverend Dr. Chris Holmes. And I won't be able to do it justice, but just to kind of recap, in last week's lesson, the Apostle Paul was arguing to the churches in Galatia that the law was no longer needed, that faith in Jesus as Lord was sufficient to become a member of the body of Christ. And Chris likened the law to training wheels on a bicycle, necessary as a child learns the skills of learning how to bike, but something that can actually become something of a hindrance as one becomes proficient at that task. And so similarly, strict adherence to dietary laws or requiring bodily modifications of males can inhibit the fullness of faith expression. However, there may always be vestiges of the old praxis, Chris reminded us. And so all week long, as I personally have been saying my prayers and reading my devotions, I keep hearing and muttering the little phrase that Chris shared with us, pedal, pedal, keep your balance. Pedal, pedal, keep your balance. Now, Paul had to make these arguments to the Galatians because at some point after he'd witnessed to them about Jesus, some unnamed missionary or missionaries from some of the other fledgling churches told them that in order to be a faithful Christian, you first had to be a good Jew. Now, we know that that line of thinking is errant, but I can see how it would arise. Many of the early churches were made up of mostly Jewish converts. I mean, think back with me what you remember of how the early church functioned. The apostles spread out from Jerusalem, went around the Roman world, and as they did so, they would encounter other towns and villages, and the first place they generally went was to the synagogue, where they would meet people who were ethnically Jewish, maybe a handful of converts. And there was also another group of people who hung around synagogues known as the God lovers. Now, these were not Jewish people, but they knew that the Jews were onto something good. And so they were on the periphery of that religious life. So all three of these groups were receptive to hearing the gospel about Jesus because they'd been hearing the message from their scriptures that God was going to redeem the world through the coming of God's promised Messiah. So the pump was primed, if you will. Some believed, others did not, and that set in motion enmity between the groups that led so many of the apostles to be martyred, but that's a topic for a different day. The ones who did believe and understood that this man from Nazareth named Jesus was in fact the fulfillment of the messianic promises were the first Christians, but some of them, not all, but enough of them, mistakenly believed that it was his Jewish lineage that linked them to him. And they believed and taught that if you wanted to be a Christian, you had to live as Jesus had. And that meant keeping all of the rituals and the festivals and the purity laws that he himself would have adhered to during his lifetime. Of course, a close reading of the Gospels reveals that Jesus was constantly being accused of ritually defiling himself as he associated with the wrong sorts of people. You know, the tax collectors, the lepers, women of ill repute, and so on. So Jesus was already subverting the religious order in his day, and you would think that his successor disciples would have recognized that fact, as Paul did. But for a certain subset of Jesus' followers, keeping kosher was a small price to pay to align themselves to Jesus. But the Galatians are an entirely different people. They had zero connection with Judaism. They were instead Celtic. Now, this morning's lesson isn't meant to be a history lesson, but I think it's helpful to know how Celtic Galatians ended up in the Anatolian highlands in what's modern-day Turkey now. You see, the Celts were an ancient people a group of interrelated tribes with similar languages, customs, and a pagan religion, and they occupied most of northern Europe, sort of north of the Alps and to the west, including the British Isles. They were quite bellicose, and they were often feared by their neighbors. In 278 BC, three large tribes of them, who occupied the eastern portion of the Celtic historic range, the Tessasages, the Trachmi, and the Tolestobogi, these three tribes left their traditional homeland in northeastern Europe and invaded what was then the heart of civilization, and that was Greece. Now, the Greeks called the Celts Galatians. They were renowned for their ferocity in battle and the fact that when they fought, they did so buck naked. Anyone seen the statue of the dying Gaul in the Capitoline Museum in Rome? That's a Roman copy in marble of a bronze statue that was from ancient Greece, that was from this era. Gauls is what the Romans called them. No matter their name, the barbarian horde of men, women, children, and their animals swept south down over what we now think of as the Balkan region of Europe, and they met little resistance. They descended into the Peloponnese, and there they started attacking various city-states in Greece. Now, they kind of met their match with the Greeks. Greeks had training, Greeks had armies, standing armies, and they were able to push them back. And so the Celts then pivoted, and they went to the east, instead looking towards Asia Minor. Now, at this point in history, the Bosphorus Strait was controlled by the Ptolemaic Empire, and they were mostly in Egypt, but they held that important piece of real estate for trade purposes. And if you remember your history, that was one of the kingdoms that splintered off of Alexander the Great's empire. Ptolemy Soranus was the king there, and he heard this mob was coming, and so he and his army crossed over the Hellespont, and they met the Celts in battle in what's now Macedonia. During the battle, he was captured. Now, ordinarily in the ancient world, when a king or a great leader, general, or something like that is captured, there's a protocol. You send out scouts and argue about how much ransom we need to pay to get our person back. It was a way of getting tribute from your enemies. But that's what civilized people do. These were barbarians, and so they instead executed Soranus, and they cut off his head, they put it on a pike, and they began to parade it around the battlefield, which completely terrified his army, and they scattered. So now, with no enemy before them, the Celts themselves crossed the Hellespont and kept going east until they ran into the next remnant kingdom from Alexander's reign, which was the Seleucid Empire. Now, I won't bore you with all the battles. There were many. They won some, they lost some. But eventually, the empire, which was so much bigger, was able to throw enough manpower at this invading problem, and they pushed them up into the Anatolian highlands, these mountains, to modern-day Turkey, as I mentioned. And then, once they got them up there, they stationed garrisons for decades, generations, around that perimeter to keep them up in the highlands. And it worked pretty well. It wasn't a perfect system. Sometimes raiding parties would come down from the mountains and hit caravans or hit a village or something like that. But for the most part, the Celts were separated from the rest of the civilized world. As I think about this history, I can't help but remember my own Celtic ancestors who were similarly hemmed in up in the Appalachian Mountains, also a warlike people. The Galatians were there isolated until the rise of the next empire, which was Rome. Technically, it was a republic at that point. Rome began expanding its reach eastward. In 188 BC, they turned first to the Seleucid Empire and attacked their holdings in Greece. And in that war, the Celts backed the Seleucids. I mean, they'd been beaten by them, so I think they figured they were choosing the winning side. And they sent bands of mercenaries to fight alongside them. And for that betrayal, the Romans next attacked them. And of course, you know about the might of Rome. With their legions of well-trained soldiers, they marched into the mountains and they soundly defeated the Galatians. And after that, they then put provisional governors over them to rule them and make them pay tribute. 100 years later, another political power arose. This time it was on the north side of the Black Sea. The kingdom of Pontus. And of course, the Romans did what Romans do. In 63 BC, they attacked. And this time, the Galatians sided with the Romans. And after the war was over, after they were victorious, the Romans rewarded this action by making Galatia a province of Rome and granting a certain type of citizenship to the male inhabitants. Now, in early Rome, there were different tiers of citizenship. Originally, the main distinction was between patricians, those who had inherited their status as the original families of Rome. They claimed to go all the way back to Romulus and Remus, and the plebeian. These were the ordinary citizens who enjoyed fewer rights, but were still above slaves and alien residents. And this led to civil unrest because the patricians saw themselves as something above the law. There were instances where a patrician would, say, seize the property of a plebeian or accuse a plebeian of a crime, perhaps falsely, and imprison them with no due justice. There were even instances of murder. And the only thing a plebeian could do was to go to the patricians and argue his case. But you can see the problem inherent in the system. If you're arguing a case against a patrician with another patrician, whose side are they going to take? In 449 BC, it came to a crisis, and the plebeians revolted, and they far outnumbered the patricians, and so they demanded that their rights be enumerated, and so a compromise was reached. They were. The Roman Senate decreed that all the laws governing citizens in the Republic were to be written on 12 bronze tablets that were displayed in the Forum, and these outlined the rights that every man had, including the right to choose how his property was divided upon his death. So maybe he left his heirs something, maybe he cut them out. Likewise, citizens had the right to adopt non-biological children, just as Julius Caesar did with Augustus. And so these laws were so very important at the core of who Roman citizens were. Students used to sit in the Forum and just study them. They would try to memorize them. And originally, these rights for the citizens of Rome were just for the Roman city itself. But over time, they expanded, first to the entire Italian peninsula, and then as the Republic and then the later Empire expanded around the Mediterranean, these rights were carried out into the provinces. Copies of the law were erected in other places. And yes, there were still tiers of citizenship. A provincial citizen had no hope of becoming a senator in Rome, but membership had its privileges. You remember in the book of Acts, when a Jewish mob attacked Paul, they grabbed him in the temple, and a Roman cohort showed up, and to kind of have a quick peace, they arrested him. But they didn't know what was going on, why the Jews were mad at Paul. And so the next step was to flog him, and they were going to beat the truth out of him, I guess. But as they were getting ready to do so, Paul said to the centurion who was standing by, "Is it legal for you to flog a Roman person who is uncondemned?" Well, it wasn't. Paul, a citizen, if you'll remember, he knew his rights. Paul was what's known as a civ, a Roman citizen who had lesser rights than someone born in Rome or on the Italian peninsula, but whose ancestors had performed some sort of meritorious service to the empire. Now, in full disclosure, you can also purchase citizenship. But some scholars think that Paul's family business of making tents for the army gained them their status. Well, we know how the Galatians got theirs. It was a little more straightforward. They had literally put their lives on the line for the empire. Now, we have no way of knowing how Paul was so successful in converting these former barbarians into Christians, but could his point of connection been the fact that both of them had been outsiders, he a Jew, they a Galatian, and now they were both Roman citizens? They were now inside. The fact that Paul told them, though, that there was more than just citizenship in Rome. There's something more here. There's more to the world than meets the eye. That God's kingdom is breaking into the world and that they've been chosen to be a part of it. What a compelling message. What an amazing thing to tell them. And these arguments that we've seen Paul make in the past few weeks in this sermon series is that God has been acting in history through a particular people, the descendants of Abraham, but that with the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, God's salvific acts are now expanding to all people. To steal from Chris, it's time for the training wheels to fall off. But it's also a message for those who never had a bike to know what's being given to them. In our reading today, Paul pivots from the language of theology and history and crafts an analogy from the language of Roman law. He's telling the Galatians that they've been included in God's redemptive plan not because they've earned it or because they have the proper pedigree, but because God chose them. I mean, think about how far they've come as a people in 350-ish years, roughly. They've gone from a naked barbarian horde to a people imprisoned by geography and armed garrisons, to a defeated people ruled over by a distant empire, and then to soldiers and citizens in that same empire that was, at the time of Paul's arrival, enjoying the great Pax Romana, the Roman peace of Augustus. And now Paul comes in and tells them, it's not over. There's more. You've inherited more, a kingdom in which you won't have any sort of subservient citizenship, but that we'll all be equal. We could see God's long game of history playing out, where becoming a part of the body of Christ has nothing to do with family lineage, place of birth, ethnicity, political affiliation. Doesn't matter what your gender is, what your citizenship status is, whether you keep religious purity laws or not. No, all that matters is faith that God's grace is sufficient. What an amazing story of liberation. And if one knows this to be true, how it can change the trajectory of one's life. Back when I was in seminary 25 years ago, one of the great preachers in America was just down the road over at Emory, at the Candler School of Theology, Fred Craddock. Whenever I had the chance, I'd go hear him preach. And he used to tell a story that I think perfectly illustrates this phenomenon. Craddock said that he and his wife, Nettie, were vacationing once up in the Smoky Mountains near Gatlinburg, Tennessee, just a short vacation. And one night they found this quiet little restaurant where they looked forward to a private meal, just the two of them having a couple of hamburgers. And while they were waiting for their meal, they noticed a distinguished white-haired elderly gentleman moving from table to table, visiting the guest. He was, you know, slapping people on the back and shaking hands. Looked like a politician. And Craddock said he secretly hoped that the man wouldn't make it around to their table, but he did. And the man then asked them where they were from and what they did. And when Fred mentioned that he was a seminary professor, in fact, a preaching professor, the man then grabbed a chair and sat down with him and said, I want to tell you a story about a preacher. He said, I'm Ben Hooper, and I was born not far from here. And he pointed out the window at one of the mountains. And he said, my mother wasn't married when I was born, so I had a hard time. When I started school, my classmates had a name for me, which wasn't a nice name. I used to go off by myself at recess and during lunchtime because the taunts of my playmates cut so deeply. What was worse was going downtown on a Saturday afternoon and feeling every eye in town boring a hole through me because they were all wondering who my real father was. But when I was about 12 years old, a new preacher came to town, and I would go sneak into his church to hear his sermons. He had a booming voice. He was a big man. But I always got out early, so I wouldn't have to confront him. But he said, one day that preacher said the benediction so fast that I got caught and had to walk out with the other parishioners as we exited the church. And he said, I could feel every eye there looking at me. And just about the time I got to the door, I felt this big hand on my shoulder. I looked up and saw that the preacher was looking down at me. Who are you, son? Whose boy are you? The preacher asked. He said, I felt the old weight come on me. It was like a big black cloud. Even the preacher was putting me down. He said, but as he looked down at me, studying my face, he began to smile, a big smile of recognition. Wait a minute, he said. I know who you are. I see the family resemblance. You are a son of God. He said, that was the most important single sentence ever said to me. Craddock said with that, he smiled, stood up, shook their hands, and then moved on to another table. And it was only after he'd moved across the restaurant that Craddock realized that he remembered that Ben Hooper had been twice elected the governor of Tennessee. Friends, this is the good news of the gospel. In Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. There's no longer Jew or Greek. There's no longer slave or free. There's no longer male and female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. Amen.
We all have ways of giving to the church, sometimes with our service and our hearts and our hands. And if you wish to do so now financially, there is a QR code in the bulletin on page 10, or you could also give online, of course.
Thank you.
us pray. To the work of this church, which is weaving a tapestry of love and action, we call community. We dedicate our lives, and these are our offerings. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Gracious God, maker of all things, seen and unseen, in all the seasons of our lives, we find you. In every moment, in every event, we find you. When we are joyful, you are there. When we are fearful, you are there. When we are afraid, you comfort us. Your abiding presence is something we know that we can trust, and for that, we are so grateful. It is in that gratitude that we turn to you today in prayer. God, you know everything that we carry in our hearts, even the things that we're not willing to admit to ourselves. Help us to turn over to you all of those things that burden us and to find your peace. When we are feeling that we must carry the weight of the world on our shoulders, help us rely on you. When we're feeling alone and isolated, help us to experience your presence. And always help us to lean into you, for you are the great comforter of our lives. We pray this day not only for ourselves, but for our neighbors and in the world. We pray for those who are afraid and uncertain. Help us seek to make this good earth a safe home for all your children. We confess that despite our abundance, many of your children live in poverty and want. And we know through your words and the prophets and the apostles that this is neither your will nor your purpose. We bring to you our own personal concerns for our families and our communities. And in all these things, we ask for strength to face the hard realities of the world, not to despair, but to stand with the vulnerable, the victims of violence and injustice, and those who live on the margins. Help us release our concerns into your hands. Empower us to discern that which we are powerless to change, but also give us the boldness to risk changing the things we can. And then, grant us spirits that we seek to serve in our worlds, guiding us that we might venture out into the courage and journey that you have entrusted to us in the way of Jesus. Our hands, our hearts, our lives, and our gifts offered to you. And we pray all these things in the name of Jesus, praying the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, we all have rights and privileges, those of us claimed as heirs of God, but that also means we have duties and obligations. In the rest of Galatians, Paul outlines some of those responsibilities that Christians have to one another and to the world, and we'll be hearing more about those in this ongoing sermon series. But until then, go out into the world in peace, have courage, hold on to what is good, return no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the suffering, honor all people, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Alleluia. Amen.